It indulges some fun ideas.
Oh, that's good. Again, I'd rather have something that's actually trying to be interesting and trying to do something different than just follow a traditional mold.
We should be live.
God, we already have donations. Holy moly.
It keeps happening.
It never stops.
And we look pretty live to me.
Yeah, absolutely. Chat, how are our... How are you? How are our levels? And happy Wednesday.
You on Crazy for Life. In with the opening super chat, $5, saying, based on the data I collected from your reviews, I created the perfect 10-point grading scale for writing reviews. See below. And then he only goes and uses his member chat for 27 months. To say 10 excellent, 9 good, 8 okay, 7 fine, 6 not quite bland, 5 no opinion, 4 bland, 3 weird, 2 enjoyably bad, 1 bad, 0 terrible. That certainly is a scale.
That is a scale. I don't feel like there can be a no opinion. You gotta have an opinion on something. Like 5 can't be no opinion. It has to be real average.
I don't really have an opinion
on the scale.
Sid Meier's Alpha Centauri.
Okay, so there you go. Okay, I stand corrected.
I've never played it. It's not my thing.
Yeah.
Anyway, welcome everyone to the post-CP stream, where this week's subject of Zero Punctuation, on the site at least, was Hell Pie, a game that's, let that speak for itself. An indie platformer that... I think shows some actual effort.
Okay, that's good.
There's some good design to it.
Okay, also good.
But I do feel it lets itself down by being really unnecessarily gross and crass.
Yeah. So when you were telling me about this game, obviously the first thing that came to mind was Conker's Bad Fur Day.
Yes.
And I imagine that was something that the developers were inspired by as well. How do you feel like it compares to that late N64, somewhat beloved game from Rare?
Well, as I said in my review, this game feels like Conker's Bad Fur Day without the wit. Mm. There were witty bits in Conker's Bad Fur Day. Mm-hmm. There were actual jokes.
Yes.
This game, however, it just has a dude masturbating, and that's the joke.
I see. Wonderful. Chat says I am very low. Do you
not
have the
really masturbating though? Oh, fine. Hang on.
I mean, would it have been even grosser if he was really masturbating? So it's probably good that he was just doing a little masturbation facsimile.
Well, the game hardly needs to be coy. All right, your volume is higher now.
Okay, we are officially higher.
I was just surprised this game didn't get like a higher profile because, as I say, it looks like there's some energy gone into it. It doesn't feel like, you know, it was just hacked out like a lot of indie games on Steam do.
Yeah, and it feels like 3D... platformers are such a kind of a beloved nostalgic genre that whenever one comes along, it gets attention. You know, whether that be
Hat in Time's a great game.
Yeah.
Everyone should stop watching this tosh and play it right now. They haven't played
it. We'll leave it in the background and then leave a dono and then subscribe and then you can leave and go play Hat in Time.
Complete the checklist and then go play Hat in Time.
You're very small. I'm realizing, like, you're almost smaller than a toilet.
Is how they sort of manage to create platforming environments out of mundane settings.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we're just in an office corridor, but because we're so small, it's a 3D platforming environment.
Yeah. Who's this? This is just a large devil? This game has got a lot of large devils.
With tits. Nicely framed nipple there, just on the side.
Yeah, that's good. Richard with a $2 donation says, I am going to play Hat in Time.
Good for you.
Richard, you made the right choice. Oh, yeah, very gross. Yes. Extremely gross.
Yes, here is a case of the game being unnecessarily gross, in my view.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I hardly want to talk when it comes to immature humor and gross-out humor.
Sure.
I just don't feel this game wields it with any kind of wit or care. It's just, look at this, ha ha ha.
Yeah, and I mean, there's like, you know, a game that's coming out tomorrow that I think you're covering next week. Cult of the Lamb has its share of, I would say, less gross and more sort of cartoonish violence and sort of that gruesome things.
The juxtaposition of the cartoony against the violent and adult.
Yeah, but it seems like from what I've played it, that juxtaposition works well in that, whereas this... Like you said, it seems like gross for the sake of being gross, and then it doesn't really, I mean, so far, do anything to, like, speak to the mechanics of a platformer?
Not really. I mean, the whole cartoon platformer thing feels kind of separate from the gross thing.
Yeah. It almost feels like they wanted to make a platformer, couldn't decide on an aesthetic, and then someone was like, well, let's just do... disgusting hell.
Let's do gross.
Yeah.
The kids love gross. Oh, bugger, I fell.
Kids do love gross. Yeah, the kids are sickos. I think we can all agree on that. Cade Brockhausen with a $5 donation. Thank you so much, Cade. Says, I'm going through a bit of a pinatical rough spot, but I'm happy to give you a little helping hand.
Financial.
But what did I say? Pinatical?
Yeah.
I said pinatical, which... If I'm going to be honest, that's not even a word. So I turned it into a pun that didn't make sense. Pinancial.
I guess it sort of sounds like piratical, which isn't piratical. Really a word, which isn't really a word either.
No, and that's not how I would describe a rough spot. So, Cade, I'm sorry that you're going through a bit of a pinancial rough spot, but I'm very happy for you to give us a helping hand. Cade, you are more clever than I am. Thank you. Will Cooling with a £2 donation. Thanks so much, Will. Says, any chance of a ZP / slight something else on the fan indie RLM game?
I didn't know there was one.
No. Is it made by... fan game. I assume it's not made by them. What is it? What kind of a game is it?
Yes. Tell us more.
Chat, no? Tell us more. I'm going to assume the answer is no. But if the game's really interesting, maybe. What would it be like the Cool Spot game? Like, do you play as one of them going on like a 2D platforming adventure?
That seems
it's a
like
VR
very...
simulation of the studio. Oh, well, that just sounds like. I mean, I don't know how much there is to talk about that, but that sounds neat. If you're a fan of that stuff,
VR games are the new CD-ROM games.
CD-ROM
games used to be just a thing where you'd like just walk around a room. And
yeah.
It'd be like a little FMV of a dude talking to you, and completely insipid and completely lacking in game mechanics.
And yeah,
VR,
I remember.
And like VR for the longest time was just that: just go into a room and something talks to you, and you're supposed to go, "Ooh, look at all the things we can do."
And my thing is, if it's a VR game based on their studio, which is just like a building in Milwaukee. I've lived in a bunch of buildings in Milwaukee. I don't need VR of that. That was like my late teens and early 20s were just living in a bunch of buildings in Milwaukee.
You could just go on Google Street View or something.
Yeah. Well, listen, I want more games that take place in Milwaukee, so I'm glad that does take place in Milwaukee. Good for that game. Blue Version says, this isn't even gross, it's just dull.
We haven't really gotten to the gross stuff yet.
Yeah, I think at the end of the 2-hour mark, we'll say we can all declare gross or dull, or probably both, if I'm being honest.
This is all like the setup so far.
That's just a butt. What's that butt doing there? Canteen Wizard.
I'm just going to remind him of pie right now. So, our quest is that we're going to make the pie for Satan's birthday.
Oh, that's nice.
And we need to pick up all the ingredients.
Okay, that's like the... Is that just your mission right now, or is that the entire goal of the game?
Yeah, basically. It's a collect-a-thon platformer, but instead of, like, stars or hourglasses or whatever, we're collecting the individual ingredients for a pie.
Okay.
The ingredients are all really gross things, like used tampons and shit.
Okay, it's not like... You're not making, like, a huckleberry pie, like a nice pie.
No, we're making used tampon and spunk pie. Because the kind of pie Satan likes.
You said you like key lime pie, and some people like used tampon and spunk pie, so to each their own. Red beer.
I feel like that's not a great taste sensation, though. The sourness of the lime combined with the sweetness of the crust creates an effective combination.
Yeah.
You don't really say the same about used tampons and spunk.
Yeah. I mean, maybe in hell, maybe like tastes are different in hell. Like in the same way people with long COVID, their taste buds like literally transform. Maybe that's how hell works. I don't know. I've never been to hell, so I don't know. That was just a guess.
So this is where we collect the central core game mechanic for this game.
Is it a little nugget? We enslaved cherub?
We pick up a disgusting cherub.
Wonderful.
And the cherub helps us jump.
Red Beer, been a member for 2 months, using their bonus content to say, in less than a month, I'm having my last test to become a lawyer, and watching you helps me with my anxiety, so thanks for everything. Red Beer, that's awesome, and pre-congrats, and good luck on the last month.
Yes, it's one of the big ones, isn't it?
Yeah, I hope you're a good lawyer, like Daredevil.
Yes, a nice lawyer.
Like Daredevil.
Be a nice crime-fighting lawyer.
Yeah, yeah. But I hope you don't lose your vision. And if you do lose your vision, I hope you get other senses.
Be a good lawyer like that dude who was doing the Alex Jones prosecution.
Oh, he was a great lawyer. That was good. That was just a lot of mic drops. I was a big fan of that. John Connor with a $2 Canadian donation. Thank you so much, John. Says, with the drought over, what are y'all eager about?
Marty reminded me that Saints Row is coming out this week, or we can code for it this week.
Pretty soon, yeah. I think it comes out in like 2 weeks, but I think the code should be in shortly. But that's exciting. You're gonna have Cult of the Lamb next week. It sucks that Marvel XCOM game, Midnight Suns, I was looking forward to that, and that got delayed. So this fall is looking pretty slim pickings-y, honestly. Like, we're out of the doldrums, but still in...
Getting fun indie stuff in thick and fast, though. We got codes. Great.
That's
I've been playing codes for Curse to Golf and Fashion Police Squad and Midnight Fight Express, and they were all worth my time. I dismissed none of those.
No, and we have this game Immortality, the follow up to Telling Lies and Her Story that I'm really excited about coming out in a few weeks. And Yahtzee's really excited about The Last of Us remake, so that's coming soon as well. Yeah.
I'll be all over that. Over that with cum.
Just like a hell pie. Absolutely just like a hell pie.
So I've pretty much demonstrated the core movement mechanic here. We swing on our cherubby man. And I like this mechanic. It's got that sort of core Mario game thing where it's nuanced. It's easy to pick up, but you can get some... you can do some interesting things once you've mastered it.
Oh, so he doesn't need to connect to anything. You just sort of plant him at a spot and it turns into your grapple hook spot.
Yeah, but if you just jump once, then you're usually not high up enough off the ground to be able to swing effectively. So you have to factor that in.
Okay. Can you do multiple swings in a row, or is that like an ability?
That's an upgrade. Yeah. You have to get some upgrade points to do that.
Okay, I do as a... you mentioning Mario, that is... I feel like that could be a very interesting core conceit to make interesting movements and puzzles. So, but we'll see if... I'm judging by your thoughts, I'm feeling it doesn't pull the game out of its kind of grossness.
Yeah, well, the grossness is one problem. The other problem is, like, towards the end, you sort of get a little bit overpowered in terms of movement, because you can swing five times before landing.
Yeah, yeah.
And you can like attack as a double jump as well. You get an upgrade that does that. Mm. So a lot of the platforming stuff you can just bypass.
Yeah. Katura Cowboy with 35ZAR. Thank you so much, Katura Cowboy. Says, hey, Yahtzee, is Cult of the Lamb worth playing? If you're planning to review it, a vague answer is fine. Just wanted to know if I should try it out.
It's worth a look. I am reviewing it next week as it happens.
Yeah. Also, we have our 3MR from Frost is currently available on YouTube, so you can check that out if you want to know a little bit more about it.
If you're not familiar, it's a hybrid base management roguelike dungeon crawler.
Mm-hmm.
Themed around you being the head of a cult.
Yeah.
It's sort of like The Binding of Isaac, but with crafting and base management elements.
Yeah. And less, I think it's less gross. There's probably like less poo, right? Fewer poos?
I was thinking about that, because someone brought up Binding of Isaac in the comments to my review for this game, and I was thinking, how does Binding of Isaac get away with it, and this game doesn't, just having so much poo around?
There's a lot of poo. Less realistic poo?
I think it might be because Binding of Isaac isn't really going for the facetious comedy tone.
No. It's actually like kind of dark when you really get into like the nitty-gritty of what's going on and why it's happening.
It's just in that art style, because that's just what that guy can do.
Yeah. I mean, I think I personally think the art style is pretty ugly of that and Super Meat Boy, and I know that's like kind of the point, but I guess it's just not, doesn't really aesthetically jive with me. But I mean, some people love it. Jack loves it. Who am I to say something Jack loves isn't good?
It's a good time killer, Binding of Isaac, yeah. I think.
Strike Warlock with a $5 donation. Thank you so much, Strike Warlock. Says, Yats, if you get a chance, give Persona 5 Royal a shot. I didn't care about Persona 5's ending a week after I finished it, but Persona 5 Royal's ending is still on my mind after 2 years.
You remember I've done like 19 videos talking about how I like Persona 5, right?
Yeah, a lot of Persona 5.
Yeah, and I've mentioned many times that I've played through Persona 5 Royal in my spare time over the course of about 6 months.
Yes.
Someone doesn't watch extra punctuation.
Congrats, Strike Warlock. Your $5 has gone into the past, and past Yahtzee was motivated by the $5 to play Persona 5 Royal. Do you think you're going to play Persona 3? Because I know you haven't played that one, and that one's...
No, because everything I've heard is that it's like the way Persona 4 was Persona 5, but not so much. Persona 3 is just Persona 4, but not so much. So I feel like I don't really want to play something that's just the same thing but less of it.
Yeah, and it's a real downer of a story that is less about fun hangs with the buds and more of, oh no, God is coming to kill us, like a Shin Megami Tensei game, which it's fun, I feel it's like funny is not the think, vibe you're going for.
Yeah, it's funny to think how they went from that to Persona 4. Persona 4 is a very fun vibes game.
Oh, and it's a wonderful little Scooby-Doo, small-town Scooby-Doo. I love it.
I wonder what sort of, you know, sea change happened at Atlas, that they stopped going from the grim Shin Megami Tensei vibe to that out of nowhere.
Yeah. Yeah, because 1 and 2 are definitely grim. But it seems like with 3, they kind of locked down the modern mechanics and flow. And then with 4, they were able to... 4 very much feels like a refinement and then a move towards the stuff you and I like about Persona. And then 5, probably even more so. Speaking of 3D platformers, I'm not Greg Gaffin. Well, who are you then? With a €4.99 donation, says, Yas, did you ever play Demon Turf? Based on our not at all totally one-sided parasocial relationship, it seems like something you'd enjoy. Do you know about Demon Turf?
No, never heard of it.
Came out, I think, I want to say late last year, maybe like 9 months ago or so, and it was an indie 3D platformer. It was kind of weird. Your character was like flat in 2D, but you were moving around this 3D world, and like the flatness didn't really come to the gameplay like Paper Mario, but it was just the way you looked. It was almost like they only animated like 10 frames for this character, and so your character is very much almost like a flat little paper man running around these worlds.
Huh. Sounds weird.
Yeah, it had a neat... I remember the thing that stuck with me was a neat checkpoint system where you can... I can't remember it exactly, but you choose where to checkpoint in levels. and
In Ori and the Blind Forest.
Yeah. And it was either like you had only a finite amount of them, or you had to find certain, you know, you had to find them in levels to use them. But it was a neat thing to, you know, if you were getting stuck at a particular spot, it sort of, you know, if you could create your own bonfire in a Souls game, allows you to skip a lot of the, you know, I want to get through this thing, but I don't want to have to do the run back to it.
It's funny how Ori and the Blind Forest had that save where you want to save as like one of its central unique mechanics. And then the second Ori game just didn't have it.
Yeah, and it felt like such a neat idea, especially because, I don't know, maybe they added it late because they knew some parts of Ori 1 were like really fucking hard. And I felt like Ori 2 was a little easier. So maybe that was like a last minute decision to playtesting said people are having too much trouble and having to back, you know, having to replay sections too much. So it seemed like an easy way to sort of offset that. Andrew Whitewinner with a $1.99 donation said, thank you so much, Andrew, said, I found a Mog World Q&A from 12 years ago. Loved it.
Huh, I don't even remember that. I don't remember doing a Q&A for Mog World. I do so many things.
And especially 12 years ago. I'm going to be honest, that's a long time. I don't remember anything about 2010. It's all a blur.
Oh my god. I've only written like 6 books in 12 years. I need to step things up.
6 books and 500 zero punctuation reviews.
I'll never be the next Michael Crichton at this rate.
Do you like Michael Crichton?
No.
All right, there you go.
I've read a few of his books, and he always feels like one of those writers who puts the research on the front load. So there's always a scene where one character says, that person just mentioned science fiction concept, and I was wondering, what is science fiction concept? And then another character pulls a fucking screen down. One of the books had actual fucking diagrams during that scene.
Oh, wonderful.
I guess that's what separates the hard sci-fi author from people like me.
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of the part, like, in my mind, if you are if you're an author who's doing a lot of research, like, one of the points of your research should be to be able to take that knowledge and then very, you know, digest it and give it to us without us realizing that we're learning, as opposed to being like, all right, here's the first day of your semester course on dinosaurs. Time for you to learn.
Yes, I also heard he was a climate change denying lunatic, Powell Park.
That's surprising. Yeah, that's generally surprising, honestly. Strike Warlock again, been a member for 28 months. Holy moly, Strike Warlock. Thank you so much. Said, oh, my bad. I assume you meant Persona 5 instead of Persona 5 Royal.
Look at me go.
Is your character going to throw up, like in Snake Eater? No. If you spin around enough, you just throw up.
See, that's the kind of detail you expect of a man like Hideo Kojima.
Yeah. Cade Brockhausen with another. I've been a member for 2 months using the early access comment to say my pun was wittier than this entire game. So far, Cade, I think you were right. Oh, this looks nice. I've just seen the background right now of sunshine. I like that. Okay. Yeah. This is a beach. This is good.
It's pretty nice. Now we take a sort of Mario, I guess, it's sort of a Mario Sunshine-y sort of feel.
Is this your hub world?
Yeah, we're in a sort of hub level. We have to find the sub-hub levels, the sub-hubs.
Sub-hubs, delicious.
And we'll be going those levels to find like the collectibles we have to find.
Nice.
So we're looking for some yogurt, some puss eye, and a bug.
Just a bug? Just one bug?
Also, oh, there's that used tampon we need.
Right.
You thought I was being facetious, but no.
I kind of was hoping that you were just pushing it a little bit further than it actually was. But
nope. Gotta have that used tampon.
Honestly, in a game, maybe you don't. Maybe you don't. Andrew Hickabottom said Super Mucky's Tale, which I'm a big fan of.
Oh, there we go.
Super Lucky's Tale. Really, really fun 3D platformer. Super Mucky's Tale is very good.
We just picked up one of many upgrade collectibles.
Mm-hmm.
There's another one over here. Who's ready for some more unnecessary, disgusting violence?
I am not, but I feel like for the sake of science, we should show.
And they force us to abet the game by making us mash the A button to do it.
Rip the horn off this little thing?
Oh, yeah. This blameless, adorable thing.
Well, that was unnecessary. Scavenger with a $2 donation. Thanks so much. Scavenger said, did you like The Martian? Lots of science in that. Did you read / watch the movie The Martian?
I read the book The Martian because at the time when it was popular.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it was all right. Some of the characters sort of grated against me. But sometime later, I realized or discovered that the author had also created a really shitty MS Paint webcomic I'd once read.
Is that
and
true?
That sort of,
Andy Weir?
Yeah, and that sort of tainted my memories
Funny.
Of the book a bit. I looked back on all the
Funny.
Shitty dialogue and thought, now it makes sense.
That's genuinely funny. I did not know that.
Okay, we
do you remember what the webcomic was about?
It was one of those Penny Arcade-style self-insert webcomics. It was called...
Gotcha.
Casey and Andy, I think?
Okay. It's funny.
I mean, I can't judge. We all made shitty webcomics in the late 90s, early 2000s. Just some of us moved on. I guess he did.
Well, he moved on, right?
Didn't improve his
some sins
much.
Can't be forgiven.
Oh, bugger. So the reason why we murdered that small, adorable creature is so we could get the boost horns. Now we can run very fast with our horns.
Okay. But you kind of run a little out of control. It's harder to move and do tight turns when you're running at super speed. A lot of pentagrams. Andrew Higginbottom with the most important question says, how is Cone Dog Yahtzee? How is our wonderful Cone Dog doing? Daw!
How are you?
Not a fan of Hell Pie. Not a fan of Hell Pie.
Fan of sleeping, though.
Oh, I would be too. How long does Toffee have to wear the cone?
Another week or so, I think.
Yeah. How long do you think you could wear a cone if you had to?
I reckon I could make it work.
Yeah.
For I am a human with opposable thumbs, and I can scratch my bollocks without needing to also use my mouth.
That's true. Scavenger says that's one flimsy-ass cone. Yeah, well, we don't want to like put a giant like concrete shackle.
Yeah, he's a tiny dog. He's a little tiny dog.
Yeah, you can't have it be heavy that he can't even like hold his neck up.
Captain Ninja says it's basically like a Victorian ruff. You mean Elizabethan ruff? Victorian is a long time after the ruffs were in fashion, Captain Ninja.
Look at that little ruff fact for you guys.
Actually, I seem to remember on the invoice that the vet gave us, it was actually referred to as an Elizabethan collar. I don't know if that's
funny. Really?
I don't know if it's to make the dogs feel better about it.
Well, I mean, I feel like it would make you feel better about it more than the dogs. Unless your dog's a big history buff, which maybe Toffee is. That wouldn't surprise me, if I'm honest. Dimitri says, the platforming loop looks fun, even though the game seems like it was desperately in need of a comedy writer.
Yeah.
I mean, less a comedy writer, more just like the entire scenario is like... Do you think, with all the same visuals and everything, do you think clever writing could have made grossness...
Well, this game certainly doesn't have clever writing.
Yeah.
I mean, it's got dialogue, but I'd feel like it's very rarely trying to do actual jokes.
Yeah.
A lot of it feels just very matter of fact. But this was a German game, so maybe there's some translation issues.
Yeah. It's so funny because this level looks like you made this level for any 3D platformer, and then they're like, well, what if we make it gross?
Yeah.
Like, I'm very curious. I would love to know if the grossness was right at the beginning or if that was something that came in halfway through when they needed a wrapping around the game that would get people's attention.
Oh, I'm sure we'll get to one of the levels that are gross.
Okay. Oh, okay, so the levels do get gross.
Yeah, I think, in fact, I'm pretty sure we're close to the sewer level.
Okay. Oh, good I can imagine that being gross. I can imagine that being pretty gross. I guess it's just the hub. That's right. So we're not in the little hellscapes. Adrian Bottom with a £2 donation says Toffee is cosplaying as the HMV logo. I like that.
If you like. His master's voice.
There you go. Yeah, Lord Terminal says, wait, it's a German game? That explains all the poo, then. I'm sure there have been German games without all the poo.
I wonder when Germany started getting a reputation for liking poo.
I mean wasn't that one of Hitler's big things?
I mean, there was that bit in South Park where they're looking at German porn and it's all full of characters going, Essen die Scheiße.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering where that all started. Germans like poo porn.
I thought that was supposedly like Hitler and Eva Braun had like a poo thing going on.
Oh, people make up whatever they want about Hitler and Eva Braun. They were also occultists, and they also were really into the English football clubs.
Damn. Didn't realize that. That's wild.
With the usual tacit statement of, well, that explains it. Yes, Andrew Hickeybottom. Germany are one of the worst countries for video game censorship. I mean, I don't know how bad it is these days, but back in the 90s, they couldn't tolerate, like, the slightest amount of violence. They had to change all the pedestrians in Carmageddon into robots. Tried to turn them into zombies that some countries were okay with, but not even the zombies were enough for Germany. Had to switch them out for robots.
Yeah, I'm curious. I don't know if there's anyone German in the chat to let us know, but I don't feel like it's as bad now. I know there was a big to-do with censoring, which I remember because I went to the Gamescom where the first of the new Wolfenstein games, Wolfenstein the New Order, was playable, so it was before it came out. And they had, for the Gamescom demos, which is in Germany, they had removed all the swastikas.
Yeah.
So we were like playing the game, and they wouldn't allow us to like capture footage of it because it was kind of like they knew we were like an American outlet that.
Yeah, I remember when Downfall came out. The fact that they were able to make a dramatization of Hitler's Germany was a big thing in Germany. They had to like jump through all kinds of hoops.
Yeah, yeah.
Because understandably, Germans don't like being reminded of that whole period.
Yeah.
It's not like in Japan where they'll often just like flat out deny it happened. I guess they just kind of want to move on.
Yeah. Understandably.
Ah, I found some poos. This must be the way to the sewer level.
Meister Kleister Heister, or as they are now known, Moister Cloister Hoister, says they recently amended the laws, Yahtzee, several years ago. Gore is allowed. Congrats. Okay.
And going
you guys
have
an International Gore Day?
And going by these poos wearing Nazi helmets, they seem to have softened on that side of things as well.
I don't know why. I really like you calling them poos. Like, I know that's what...
That's what they are.
Essentially what, yeah, but it's just weird like to be like, oh, look, there's a poo. I like it. I'm a big fan.
What would you say? Poop?
I would... like a piece of poop. Right. I think I would say, but I think you're just the writer in you is you know cutting out the fluff and just getting to the point.
Well, I do kind of like the comedic cadence of poo.
Yeah, it does. I do like it too. It does sound nice.
And yes, Winnie the Pooh was a source of much merriment when I was growing up.
I can absolutely imagine. Meister Kleister says it's more complicated. Nazi imagery is allowed for historical or satirical purposes, but games are counted as toys, and Nazi imagery is forbidden.
But Nazi poos.
But the Nazi poos.
Explain the Nazi poos, smart guy.
These are your people, Meister Kleister Heister. Tell us. So one thing is, how does the platforming feel?
It feels pretty good.
Yeah. Seems I like mean, you have like a little bit of a...
Except when I run out of jokes. I run out of jumps there.
Yeah.
It feels versatile and responsive.
Gelden says maybe this game wasn't released in Germany. I mean, that's also possible. I mean, if they're putting it on Steam, like, I'm sure they would be fine to have it sell everywhere in the world and not have it sell in Germany. That wouldn't be a big deal.
Oh. See, I got used to playing on my other save where I had the upgrade that made the attack act as a double jump.
I was about to say, you have to, like, by starting the game over, you have to kind of relearn what it was like to play the game without all the nifty upgrades.
What the hell is this, Death 2508? It's Hell Pie.
It's Hell Pie, it says right there, Helpy.
And you can find out more by watching this week's Zero Punctuation on escapistmagazine.com or on YouTube.
Or on YouTube if you... Look at that. He got it. Smart. He's so smart.
Gotta get up early in the morning to get the drop on me.
Frost says, oh yeah, I forgot this game was banned. Apparently this game is banned in Australia and New Zealand. So,
that
sorry.
Figures.
Do you think Amy's bummed? This seems like
is the sort of game that almost sort of invites being banned in certain countries. Because it's, you know, they know the extra, like, publicity will help sales in other countries.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, this game refers to itself in the Steam listing as obscene. It is a deliberately obscene game.
Yeah. Gelden says, also in this week's Zero Punctuation, we finally got a nod to Furry Hitler. So, congrats everybody.
Yeah, fine. I referenced Furry Hitler.
So all we need to do is get a little orc massage in there, and then chat will be happy. All sickos in chat.
I still haven't seen anything about orc massage.
Mm,
I've only ever heard about it in super chats.
I feel like it originated. I have a feeling someone in chat made the game, because I feel like this is the only place I've ever heard about it. So, granted, that's the same thing with Furry Hitler. So, I think we got some sickos in chat, which is fine.
Can't get in there. Have to come back later. Oh, got enough upgrade points for an additional swing. That'll help.
Andrew's trying to blame Nick, saying it's Nick's fault. He made us aware of it.
Nick, what are you doing looking around for your Steam porn games? Keep it to yourself.
He's got to find stuff to review. He can always just say, "Man, it's for work. It's research purposes." Nick's in chat saying, "Didn't do nothing."
Poo, poo everywhere. Now, here's an example of what I would call what I would consider unnecessary. Here's a big pink blobby dude with shit crusted all around his bum.
Yeah.
Hope you weren't eating while watching this.
Yeah, should we have added like a little disclaimer at the top to be like, sometimes y'all watch this for lunch, depending on where you are, and you shouldn't.
And this one's got poo all around his mouth as well.
He was eating poops, wasn't he?
Yeah, these dudes eat poo. And their hands are covered in poo and there's poo everywhere and that's the joke. And the used tampon is their object of worship. So we're gonna have to get that used tampon away from them.
Great. Also, just to let everyone know, this video will almost undoubtedly be demonetized, so all of your super chats and your donations and your memberships help greatly. Like PBS, we are sponsored by viewers like you.
Why is YouTube so squeamish about used tampons?
I've been saying the same thing. It's fucking Google, man.
Oh, wait, I don't think this was unnecessarily gross enough.
Yeah. Hmm.
Now it's exactly as unnecessarily gross as it needs
to be.
There you go.
Salvador, welcome to the chat. I'm sorry you came right at this time. So, I apologize. Andrew Hickabottom wants to know, does it have any moderately realistic erect penises in it, or is that where they draw the line?
Well, as I mentioned in my review, there's a whole hub world later set in a jungle where the standard enemies are like little penises. But there's sort of stylized penises on little legs with eyes.
Great. This game about boss fights?
Yep.
How are they?
They're boss fights.
Also, Maelstrom said the loathsome poo eater, which I'm a fan of. That's good. Very good. Well done.
I don't think I ever saw the loathsome dung eater actually eat any dung in the course of Elden Ring.
No. He's mostly just kind of covered in it. It's just kind of his armor. And I think people threw poo at him when he was being hung in the backstory.
Oh, wearing poo is the opposite of eating it.
Yeah, that is true. That's like wearing clothes is the opposite of eating clothes. Yeah, I'd agree with that.
Yeah, I have to think about it though.
Yeah. I feel like a lot of people are gonna say like, well, you know, 20 years ago you had the great mighty poo. Well, like why is this any different? But as you said at the top,
I referenced that very thing in my review.
Oh, look at that.
Yes. I mean, the Great Mighty Poo was a sequence with some wit.
Yeah, it takes a little bit to sort of turn a game into a musical. You know what I'm surprised at? We don't have more games that are musicals.
Yeah.
Well, maybe it's because it literally does take work.
Yeah, and you can't... musicals rely very heavily on timing. And you can't control the timing if the player's in charge.
That's true. I liked those levels in... did you play either of the modern Rayman games, like Legends or Origins?
I have.
They had some of the levels where they took like, they took a song like Black Betty or like some Queen song, and they sort of made it into a 2D platforming challenge. But I think with a 2D platformer, you kind of have more control over the.
Yeah.
If you're expecting the character to always be running to the right, you have a little more control over that.
Yeah, they had something like that in Rayman Origins, where you had to chase after a treasure chest, and they'd play this high up-tempo banjo music in the background.
Yeah. Some of the levels in, did you play? You might have missed it because it came out like alongside the PS5, so that sort of busy launch window. But the newest Sackboy Adventure, the Little Big Planet game.
I did not play that one.
Okay, that had a couple musical levels that were really neat, and it was almost like your actions would add to the beat and the soundscapes of the songs, but they'd be like, you know, familiar songs like Madonna songs or Britney Spears and stuff. I thought that was really neat. Also, I remember originally the plan was for Epic Mickey 2 to be a musical, and I think that game's budget ended up getting like halved, and so they had to just turn it into a bland platformer.
Well, Epic Mickey 1 was quite a disappointment for a lot of people.
It was, which people were really looking forward to it because Disney's, in terms of that sort of their Mickey license, they don't give out to just anyone, and then pairing it with Warren Spector, people were very excited.
I think it all started with some really edgy sort of fan art of like a dystopian Disney world.
Yeah.
But then they had to get Disney on board, and Disney were like, no, you can't have dystopian themes in Disney.
Everything
must be happy and lovely.
Yeah.
And then the game just felt very insipid.
Tijikar, been a member for 2 months, says, Yahtzee's was my favorite review of Furry Hitler. Congrats.
Okay.
You have the world's number one review of Furry Hitler. I'm proud of you.
I didn't review Furry Hitler.
Well, that's not what Tijikar says. And Michael Wolf, been a member for 28 months. Thank you so much, Michael, says, Yahtzee, when are we going to get a review of Xeno Saga 3? Do you mean Xenoblade Chronicles 3, or do you mean, like, the 2005 game Xeno Saga 3?
Probably won't be reviewing that one.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I know people are playing it, and they're like 150 hours into it, which seems that's too many hours. What are we doing?
Enjoying that's a lot of hours. Fashion Police Squad too much.
You've been enjoying short games. In and out of your life. Yeah.
Cult
Imagine how many like little indies you could play for that. You could play like 10 of the games you've mentioned in the time it would take to play Xenoblade Chronicles.
Cult of the Lamb, Fashion Police Squad, all the rest.
Yeah, all sorts of good little guys coming out soon. I'm excited to play Rollerdrome.
Rollerdrome at all? I was playing that. I sort of bounced off it because I was never really into the Tony Hawk thing.
I enjoyed the preview build of it.
Having to ramp off things and then press like 9 buttons.
Yeah.
You're free!
When we were talking about 3D platformers with musical sections, people thought it was Balan Wonderworld Erasure. Did you review Balan Wonderworld last year?
Certainly did. It was my worst game of the year.
Congrats! Congrats, Yuji Naka. You did it.
But, you know, as I've talked about in Extra Punctuation, I hold the worst game of the year in higher esteem than I hold the blandest game of the year.
Yeah.
Because at least the worst game is something fun to talk about.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, new skill available. What are we got? Rebound's completely useless. Don't buy that.
Dun, 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 dun.
I guess we'll just get the Hoover Up collectibles power up.
I always like that one. Does that mean like when you're close to something, it'll just draw towards you?
Yeah.
Any 3D collectible game, that's one of the first things I get because it ends up saving me a lot of time in the long run.
It's a good labor saver. Hoover Up the collectibles power.
There you go.
If you're playing any sort of game with RPG elements and one of the upgrades is enhance one's ability to collect upgrade points,
yeah,
always get those first.
Yeah, or anything that's plus 10% to collectibles, get those. Perfect. Yeah,
plus 10% XP from things.
Yeah.
Obviously, you want to get that as early in the game as possible to maximize your efficiency.
Look at that. You didn't think you'd be coming to Help High's post-CP for some life advice on how to organize your upgrade tree, did you?
Right. Just collect my thoughts while I'm surrounded by poo.
Pretty standard, yeah.
Aha. There's someone in a cage I haven't freed.
That little cherub keeps popping up in the bottom corner. It's got a little, these little boobs sticking out, everything. Yeah.
That symbol means I'm holding something, so I can't use my cherub for swinging or anything.
Oh, gotcha. Do you think it's supposed to be a take on the Ghostbusters thing? Because it kind
of
looks like
it does remind me of that, doesn't it?
Yeah, but it doesn't seem like it's a blatant, like, look at us, a Ghostbusters reference. Andrew Hickamottom with a £5 donation says, I wonder if Furry Hitler's sales jumped significantly after Yahtzee's acknowledgement of it.
I didn't actually mention it by name. I just referenced a games about anthropomorphic foxes who are also Hitler.
Yeah. Do we even know if that's what the game is? I mean, I'm assuming that's what the game is.
I don't know. All I know about Furry Hitler is that it's called Furry Hitler.
Yeah.
And from going by the screenshots, it is exactly what one should expect of a game called Furry Hitler.
Yeah. Does this one thing Conker had was a litany of pop culture references, from a level just like Aliens to a level just like The Matrix. Does this do any of that?
Not really. I mean, if you were paying attention earlier, there's the teleport pods from The Fly appear in the supermarket level.
Okay.
There's a couple of things like that, but most of the time the humor in this game feels kind of nonsensical.
Yeah, yeah.
Which can be good. But, like, turds wearing Nazi helmets, there's no real sequitur there.
I was about to say, like, what's the point there? Yeah. Huh. Lord Terminal says, okay, I need to click off the stream for a minute because now I'm starting to get nauseous. I'm going to tab over to the Splatoon 3 Direct from this morning before I cover my laptop and vomit. Are you getting nauseous because of like the content or just because it's like a 3D platform?
I've sort of gotten jaded to the poo now.
Yeah, at this point, it's just a sewer level to me. Like, it's just, which, I don't know, there's Clanker's Cavern and in Banjo-Kazooie. Like, I've played a bunch of sewer levels.
Perhaps, yeah.
Yeah, it's less like, I don't, I think, I'm imagining pretty quickly, like, this all worn off. Like, see, this dead thing, to me, I'm just like, okay. I've just grown numb to it, and it's mostly just, this isn't a very, I don't know, interesting aesthetic, I guess.
I guess
I really like 3D platformers, so.
Well, bearing that in mind, are you tempted to try this one?
I mean, the thing is, I think the platforming looks pretty neat, and I genuinely do think the cherub midair grappling hook thing is a neat core conceit. It's just like one of the reasons I like 3D platformers is like hanging out in their worlds. This, I don't know. Do I want to spend time in this world?
But you're turned off by the gross out stuff, and that just drives home my point in my review where I asked, who the hell is this game for?
Yeah, like
I think a lot of people would agree with you. The platforming looks fun. Yeah. It is fun.
Yeah.
But I think a lot of the potential audience would just be turned off by the gross stuff, and I wonder why they did that.
Yeah, it just seems like it would have been, I don't know, I guess maybe they just weren't confident in their core mechanics, or maybe like they found this really funny, and I don't know. They thought, everyone's going to find this funny.
I assume it was that. I assume there were a bunch of, you know, immature man children.
Yeah.
Who were all, all their design meetings are like conversations from Beavis and Butthead.
Yeah. but is that like, does that sort of type of person still exist in 2022? Like,
well, I guess that some of them just don't. Well, people who like Beavis and Butthead would all be like 35 now, and some of them probably don't grow up.
Yeah.
Oh no, it's the turd boss.
Callum McTavish says a South Park audience, but South Park has like a cleverness to it. This game is completely lacking. I mean, maybe they think this is witty, but they just aren't.
Okay.
Rao with a $1.99 donation said, "Sup mofos, late as fuck, VOD it is, adios muchachos." Rao, thank you so much for the donation. You are late as fuck.
Thanks for letting us know.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming in to let us know you weren't coming in.
Well, I was worried that Rao wasn't here. I was going to do like a silver alert to make sure Rao was all right.
You're doing like those stock emails the Trump campaign sends around where it's like, President Trump himself wants to know where your donation is.
He's been worried sick about you.
They literally do that. I've seen them. It's like it's like the
Nigerian scam.
It's like they have absolutely no faith in their followers' intelligence or something.
Yeah.
Oh boy. Okay, a couple of things.
There it is.
Firstly, if this is a used tampon, it's dirty on the wrong end.
It's absolutely dirty on the wrong end. I mean, I'm going to be honest. The team that thought this was funny probably don't know how a tampon works, if we're being honest.
I've got some experience with menstrual products, being a married man. Sure. I can tell you that's not the way you put tampons in.
It's not. No, you're doing it wrong. Asabo Luffy says, maybe Vati Vidya can explain the lore in this one. I think that'd be great. I think it'd be funny if Vati for April Fool's Day did a lore video on a game that does not need its lore explained.
Yeah, he hasn't done like a silly video in a long time.
No.
He did that silly one about, what's her name, who's in the Painted World of Ariarmis? Crossbreed Priscilla. He did a silly video about Crossbreed Priscilla ages ago.
Yeah.
And that made me laugh, and I'd like to see more silly videos from him.
Yeah, because those games have inherently a lot of silly elements to them, and I like when he... Those goofs. More goofs.
Ow.
Jim Morris says, I think there's a lot of people who don't understand the subtext in South Park and just think the poop jokes are funny. Maybe it's for those people. I mean, yeah, maybe it's the same people who watch, like, Taxi Driver and Breaking Bad and The Boys and, yeah, like, see the heroes as heroes and don't understand that the heroes are the bad guys.
See, I think this is a topic worth addressing. Because people always bring up, like, characters like, you know, Rorschach from Watchmen.
Yeah.
And what's his name? Walter White from Breaking Bad.
Yeah.
As characters that you must be a bad person if you like.
Mm-hmm.
But I think, you know, Rorschach has some really badass scenes in Watchmen.
Sure.
Like when he's stuck in a prison cell and just takes apart everyone who comes to kill
him. Yeah, and says, I'm not in here with you, you're in here with me.
Yeah, and I think it's easy, I think it's perfectly valid to look at that and think, wow, that kicked ass.
Mm-hmm.
I think you're not supposed to, you're not supposed to sympathize with his politics, but I think it's I think it's all right to like a character because you admire their effectiveness in situations like that.
Well, I think there's a difference between I think there's a difference between liking a character and thinking that this character is the protagonist and like that their motivations are true and just.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, Rorschach's motives are like completely wacko.
Yeah, yeah.
He's a right wing hardline conservative, and there's a strong sense that nothing he's done is helping anything.
No, no, and he eats cold beans. He doesn't even heat up the beans out of the can, which is, that's weird.
He's gross, but he kicks ass, and we'd all love, we'd all like to have the ability to kick ass, and that's fine.
Yeah. Seems great. I would love to be able to make meth as well as Walter White does. I'll never be able to, though, so.
Yes, I'd like to have a huge quantity of dosh. I'd like to have so much dosh it becomes inconvenient. I want to have berry in the desert money.
That's how you know you've really made it.
Oh, more poo-spattered bums. Great. I was wondering for a second what that thing on the wall was. Should have guessed. It's a poo-spattered bum.
Is this like is most of the poo relegated to this level, or does the poo
the poo Nazis are a recurring baddie.
Gotcha. They're like the Goombas.
Yeah, sort of.
Also, Goombas could be a poo Nazi. Like, we don't know. Like, they're little brown guys who love to march.
Hey, Mushroom Kingdom's got to have some kind of sewage control infrastructure.
Bowser's trains always ran on time.
Of course, the crown that their king is wearing is a poo.
It is a poo, yeah, and his royal scepter is a plunger.
Yeah. See, that's good. That's a small amount of wit.
Yeah, yeah. It's a very clean plunger for being a plunger in a poo land.
Yeah.
Andrew Hickabottom with another 2-pound donation. Thank you so much, Andrew. Says, this is Little Big Silent Hill Planet.
If you like.
Yeah. But again, Silent Hill's grossness and off-puttingness are
That's part of the unsettling atmosphere.
Yeah, yeah, it works in unison with the themes in the gameplay.
Yeah.
Krashikov, rightfully so, calls me out, saying that calling Goombas little brown guys who love to march is hate speech against Italians. So I apologize. I apologize, Krashnikov. Pacific Blue says Silent Hill is poo-free. I think there's a lot of implied poo in Silent Hill.
Yeah, there's a lot of brown stains on toilet walls.
Yeah, yeah, there's definitely poo.
Was that if not poo?
Yeah.
I mean, admittedly, blood dries brown, and most of the rest of the game is full of blood.
That is true.
But, you know, there's that whole bit in Silent Hill 3 where you open up a toilet and there's, like, blood everywhere. I think that's implied to be a menstruation reference.
That would make sense.
Because the whole theme of that game is pregnancy, of course.
Yeah.
Not the not a menstruation reference in the same way collecting a used tampon is a menstruation reference.
No, no. Or all the blood you collect throughout Bloodborne.
Yeah. Well, we'll be done with the poo levels soon enough.
Well, I'm excited for where we're going to go next. Are there kind of side quests, or is it just more of like go off the beaten path to find an upgrade point, that kind of thing?
Yeah, there's a couple of little side questy things. Mm-hmm. Like that dude gave us an extra upgrade token because we freed all his friends from their cages.
Yeah.
In the course of the level. So we're about done with Poo Town. Let's go somewhere that's disgusting in a different way.
Wonderful. Steiner says, is this still early access or nah? I don't think so.
This is fully released now. I don't review early access anymore.
You remember what the last... Was there like a straw that broke the camel's back there?
I think it was after I like did a quick review of Fortnite before it really took off. And it was still in early access.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, okay, now it's like the third most popular form of human communication.
Yeah. Yeah, Bad Trashman says, is this a kid's game? Who is this for? I definitely don't think it's a kid's game. Well, but I mean, maybe if you were like 12, this humor would really be funny.
Well, as I said in my review, this is the Conker's Bad Fur Day thing where it says it's for adults only, but... Realistically, yeah. Only kids find this sort of thing amusing.
Yeah. But I also feel like kids nowadays, like, if you have access to the internet, you've, I'm sure, seen much worse than all of this. Whereas, like, when we were kids, something like South Park coming along was still kind of like...
Yeah.
It felt like forbidden fruit, whereas just like... I don't know, there's no shortage of this on the internet.
And Conker's Bad Fur Day, to an extent.
Yeah.
Sharing videos of the great mighty poo.
Yeah.
I know all the lyrics to the great mighty poo song.
Look at that. Andrew Hickenbottom says, is this on Switch 2? I can't imagine Nintendo would allow this. I don't think it's on consoles, is it?
I think I remember reading it was like... It was penciled in for Switch, but then it was delayed, possibly because Nintendo got wind of what was actually in it.
Sure, sure. It looks like you can buy this on Xbox.
Oh, yeah.
For some reason, it took me to the UK store and not the American store, though, which I'm not sure why. Huh. So it's £20 on the UK store.
Maybe it's not in the
American. It's published by Thunderful Games, who's like a new high-profile indie publisher.
There's a lot of those covering up. What else have they published?
Let's go. And they have a logo here for Xbox and PlayStation. No Nintendo logo, though. They are publishing some upcoming games. Oh, Curse to Golf, which you've said you've been playing.
Yeah, I've been playing some of that.
Planet of Lana, which is one of the games that was very much a colorful inside-like, I believe. Not by one of the guys, but yes, an inside-like. They did The Gunk from a few months ago, Lost in Random. They published that.
That's
one. Dice game. Yeah.
Yeah, they seemed like a sort of slightly below AA publisher by the sounds of it.
Yeah, apparently they published Deadly Premonition 2, interestingly enough.
Huh.
Lonely Mountains Downhill.
So who published The Good Life?
Looks like not them. They did a couple SteamWorld games. They published that Fae. Pumpkin Jack. Do you remember? Did you play Pumpkin Jack at all in 2020? That was a 3D platformer. It felt almost like medieval. Like you played as like a. It was like a Halloween, a spooky, like a cartoonishly spooky 3D platformer where you played as like a man with a flaming pumpkin. Is that?
No, I don't believe I played that.
Yeah.
I mean, from the title. It sounds like exactly how it sounds like it should be. Like,
gotcha, gotcha. A Playism published The Good Life. Playism.
Huh. Swery just can't find someone to stick with, it seems. Ah, you bastard. Oh, you bastard again.
Double bastard.
This keeps happening. Trying to get to the horn statue so I can murder some more innocent small creatures.
They had it coming. We all have it coming. Pidey Mo, first time chat over in Twitch, says, "Hey there, thanks for playing our game. I am one of the devs with a purple heart."
Oh, well, Mo, you got some explaining to do.
There was so much poo!
Yes.
Pidey Mo, if you can answer, we were curious if the theme of the game and sort of the mature and gross stuff, was that the plan all along, or was the plan to make a 3D platformer and then at some point during the development that theme came along? I was personally curious in what order that happened.
Yeah, because I think the conclusion we recently reached was that the platforming looks fun and interesting, but a lot of people are getting turned off by the gross out stuff.
Mm-hmm. You're ripping a lot of horns off. There's just a lot of horns being ripped off.
Need to do 7 of them for this one.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of between this and Cult of the Lamb. It's a big week for sacrificing animals to deities.
Oh yeah. I was playing Bear and Breakfast just before I played Cult of the Lamb, so I was thinking it's a good week for picking up bits of wood.
That is a game where I haven't played enough of it, but I don't think you sacrifice animals to deities.
Don't think so. And except in maybe in a really abstract way.
Yeah. So is these levels with the pits, this isn't like a level, this is a like a challenge level, or is this where you get a new ability?
This is basically to practice the new ability level.
Gotcha.
So we just picked up the battering ram, which means we no longer need explosives to destroy destructible things.
Mm-hmm. Simple Simon with a $20.02 donation, which is a very random number, but I appreciate it, says, quote, "I know all the words to the great mighty poo," end quote. "Yahtzee, can my paltry pittance and pandering get you to indulge us and sing a few bars by the end of the stream?" That was a $20 donation.
Oh, I can rarely be dissuaded from singing the great mighty poo song. It goes, "I am the great mighty poo, and I'm going to throw my shit at you. A huge supply of tish comes from my chocolate starfish. How about some scat, you little twat?"
That was beautiful.
Tish, in my opinion, is a bit of a reach when it comes to euphemisms for feces.
Yeah.
But they were trying.
Yeah. Pidey Mo says, in an answer to our question, says, "We've made two platformers before, so the conclusion was that we wanted to make another one. From the beginning, it was clear we wanted to make a game which borrows from the vibes of Conker and Banjo. We struggled to find an interesting swing mechanic that came a couple of months after we started development." By the way, Mighty Poe, the username is Pidey Mo equals Mighty Poe equals Great Mighty Poo.
I picked up
the poo you were dropping. Probably shouldn't have picked up the poo he was dropping. That's not a...
And I've thought more about poo today than I'd ever want to think about it.
A big stream for poo, which we don't get those a lot, so, yeah.
Well, wait till the Cult of the Lamb stream next week. I'm sure poo will come up fairly frequently in that one, too.
Big week for poo. Chat, well, really enjoyed your rendition of the song. A lot of brilliance, a lot of bravos, a lot of claps.
Yes, I flatter myself in that I feel I have a nice baritone.
You do. You absolutely do. You sounded like the Great Mighty Pooh. So that was genuinely impressive.
I can also do a bit from The Marriage of Figaro, but I understand what sort of audience we're playing to here.
damn, audience. Yahtzee just called you out for not being opera fans. How do y'all feel?
Well, I need to sort of psych myself up for the Marriage of Figaro bit.
Steiner, first time chat over in Twitch, says, I have a question.
Hang on, I'm ready now.
Go. That was like Twista. That was very impressive. Were those words? Were those just like syllables? I guess words are just syllables. What are words if not syllables? Yeah,
it's Italian.
Gotcha.
It translates to, oh, I'm Figaro and aren't I great?
That sounds about right. Yeah. Standing ovations, bravos. A lot of bravos. Andrew Hickenbaum was worried that you're speaking in tongues.
No, that's that bit from The Marriage of Figaro where they always like do the asshole thing of trying to get the singer to do it as fast as possible.
Sure.
All right, where are we going now?
Simple Simon, look at that. Your $20 donation, much appreciated, and look how much it got us. Look how much joy it brought. Steiner had a question. Their first chat over in Twitch said, I had a question when you were talking about reviews earlier. What was your take on Inscription? Any reason you never did a ZP on it?
I just don't really get along with that sort of deck building mechanics.
Yeah.
I know it's like supposed to be like, you know, subversive and shit.
Yeah.
But I couldn't really stick with it to get to that aspect of it.
Yeah, also keep in mind Zero Punctuation is a series of reviews solely by one person with his own likes and dislikes and preferred genres and does one a week, and there's only a finite amount of weeks in the year, and sometimes just doesn't want to review something.
Nobody likes
it. Doesn't mean the game's bad, doesn't mean you can't like the game. Don't you worry about that.
Nobody likes every single kind of game.
Yeah.
I mean,
like, I always
I'm happy to be proved wrong. I've never met anyone who would like every imaginable kind of video game.
Be weird. It'd be very weird.
Yeah, you'd feel like the guy probably wasn't thinking that hard about it.
No.
Maybe they just liked all the interesting colored images appearing in front of their eyes.
Which sounds kind of nice, honestly. Yeah, it's always, kind of baffles me when you get a comment like this week on Slightly Something Else when we were talking about roguelikes. There was a couple people who were like, I can't believe they didn't bring up the Mystery Dungeon games. Like, how could they not bring up Pokemon Mystery Dungeon? And it's like, there's like, do you go to a conversation show and expect us to just list every single game? Like, yeah, should we just read a Wikipedia list? Like, it's two people bringing their own, you know, histories and likes and dislikes and experiences. And just because something's not mentioned, it doesn't mean we're trying to erase it from history.
Yeah, that's every time, though. It's like, you forgot such and such. You forgot such and such. I mean, that's partly why I did that sort of joke intro to my Boomer Shooters Extra Punctuation.
Where I listed
every single retro Boomer Shooter I could find on Steam.
Yeah, but someone's going to find one and they'll be like, why didn't you mention Black and Smith? What are we doing here?
Yeah. Clearly, we have some kind of bias against that specific game.
Yeah, I don't think we should be putting Pokemon in Mystery Dungeons, or Chocobos for that matter. Keep them out of Mystery Dungeons. Let's just ban Mystery Dungeons.
Okay. There's an upgrade pickup down there, but I have to sacrifice my progress up the mountain to get it.
Oh, that's always tough. And there's no, like, you can't just, you can't unlock a shortcut to easily get back up.
Back to the bottom of the mountain with me, then.
Blandon Ray says everybody wants their personal preferences validated. I guess it's just kind of human nature, I suppose. Yeah, but who gives a shit if we validate you?
They want to know that we belong to their tribe. They know whether they need to shun us or not.
Ad with a donation, thank you so much. Says Yahtzee, why did you stop doing judging by the cover? What was judging by the cover?
That was a first secondary video series I did for a while where I just took like cover art of and film posters and stuff and criticized the imagery with no actual connection to the content or object being advertised by the imagery.
Gotcha.
So I'd like, it was me like showing a big picture of Batman fighting Superman and explaining how the facial expression implies that this part of the face was taken from somewhere else.
Yeah.
And I guess I stopped doing it because I was bored and I felt like I was repeating myself.
There you go. Easy peasy. I also feel like in the realm of digital games, like I download all of my games, and so I'm not even sure what covers look like anymore. Like, I can look at some of my favorite games, and I don't even know if they have covers and what the covers are.
I think these days you'd say promotional art rather than cover art.
Yeah, I guess so. You know, whatever the key art is.
Oh, blimey. Oh, blimey again. Oh, blimey. See, sometimes if you start falling and you press the swing button too early, it doesn't actually activate. That was weird. I seemed to be sort of stuck in the terrain for a second there, but opening the map seemed to help.
Soy Boy Simp with a $20.69 donation. Thank you so much. It says happy 7th anniversary to on Let's Drown Out .. Dark Souls 2. Yahtzee, mommy, daddy, please stop fighting.
Okay. Thanks for the money.
What was Let's Drown Out?
It was my old YouTube series that I did with my old mate Gabe, who I haven't spoken to in ages.
Gotcha. Oh, that was the one where it was just like Let's Plays?
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Basically.
SVS Guru with a 5-euro donation. Thank you so much, SVS Guru. Says, good news. After 7 years of fruitless toil, Domino's Pizza has finally closed all its restaurants in Italy. Damn, I feel bad for the people of Italy. This is a rough day for Italy. No more Domino's Pizza, and I made fun of Goombas. So,
well, I'm sure Italy has enough pizza to get by.
They do. They probably have a decent amount of pizza. Yeah.
Okay, now we get to go inside a big whale, and things can be gross in a fleshy way. Rather than a poopy way.
Well, I've played games inside a whale. Like, Pinocchio went inside a whale, and that was fine.
Sure. I don't know what's going on with this guy.
He's doing, it's leg day. It's leg day, so he's doing single leg squats.
What's with the Prince Valiant hairdo?
Great question. Very, very, very good question. Andrew Kamab said, feeling a bit Psychonauts 2 now. Psychonauts 2 does, that had some gross, like, remember that first, that teeth level was pretty gross, but I thought that was, like,
that was sort of fit the theme.
Yeah. And especially if you're going by, like, characters.
You're inside the mind dentist. Of an insane dentist, yeah.
Yeah.
That works, that had a thematic reason.
Yeah. I like that the whale has a cafeteria in its body.
Yeah, it's like a whale restaurant.
Yeah,
they make food out of the whale, and then
like they shave off like blubber, internal blubber.
Yeah, so this whale probably exists in a state of constant agony and torment.
Yeah,
fun.
But isn't that like don't all of our bodies have like millions of little like bacteria hanging out? And what are they if not forming restaurants inside our intestine? Think about that. I also don't know if any of that's true. I don't know how the human body works, so my apologies.
Gut flora. That's
delicious.
I know that the phrase gut flora
exists. Gut flora? God! Is that like what kombucha is all about? It's like getting your gut? Like getting your gut all working?
I don't know.
American Viewer says, with a highlight message, you obviously haven't seen the documentary Osmosis Jones. I actually have not seen Osmosis Jones since theater.
I have never seen Osmosis Jones.
You're missing out. It's about an osmosis named Jones.
Well, I gathered that much.
Yeah. Lou May with a 5-pound donation. Thank you so much. Says, can Yahtzee say something kind and genuine and non-sarcastic about a game, please? I just want to witness it. I think there's plenty of reviews where he's done that.
Yeah.
There's lots on Spiritfarer.
Yeah. I love Spiritfarer. I've been enjoying Fashion Police Squad.
Yeah.
I think it might seem like a one-joke concept on the surface, but I think it's got some hidden depths and some fun gameplay, and it manages to keep the comedy energy up in ways that other comedy games don't.
Drop a link to Fashion Police Squad in
God,
chats.
I hope the embargo's not currently...
You know, it probably isn't up. This is a very small indie game, and you are saying nice things about it. So
okay,
I can't imagine it would be upset. Also, there's a demo, so at the very least, all we can say, oh, those were your thoughts on the demo.
Oh, there you go.
Get out of jail free card.
No, Frank Drebin isn't in it, Andrew Higginbottom. I suspect it's called Fashion Police Squad because then the initials are FPS, which is also what it is, an FPS.
I'm going to be honest. I did not pick up on that until right now, and I'm kind of ashamed. I'm genuinely ashamed. I should have lied. I shouldn't have said that. I should have just lied and said, oh yeah, I knew that.
Well, it only occurred to me when I, like, in the game story, they refer to their organization as the FPS.
As the FPS, yeah. Yeah, I think in none of the marketing, they never shorten it to FPS. So I think that's why I never got I never got it.
I assume it was called FPS deliberately because it is an FPS, because the title that would have made more sense was Fashion Police Department.
Yeah, I mean,
or Fashion PD.
Yeah, but that doesn't have the, oh, I get it, little cleverness. Scavenger says, why do I feel like this is supposed to be a riff on Jabu Jabu from Ocarina of Time? Well, Jabu Jabu was very much your take on No and the Whale and Monstro from Pinocchio, so as much as I love Zelda, I didn't create the idea of going inside of a whale.
Yeah, there's plenty of games that have had the idea of going inside a gigantic monster.
Kingdom Hearts 1, when you go inside Monstro?
For one. I think basically every, like, platformer, 2D platformer and shooter in the 16-bit era had the go inside the fleshy world
level. Oh, absolutely. Yeah, Banjo-Kazooie had you going inside Clanker in Clanker's Cavern.
Yeah, there was Contra, of course.
Yeah, Contra, went, definitely. Yeah.
Very frequently went to fleshy alien world.
Yeah. You know what I think's never done it, surprisingly? Metroid. I can't remember a Metroid game where you go inside something very large.
Debatable.
Yeah.
The environments do feel very organic in Metroid.
They do. Like, the walls feel very gross. Like, I don't want to touch anything in Metroid. It also has that fear of, like, that whole alien thing of, like, if I touch something, maybe this is an egg that's gonna kinda hatch and gonna bite me in the face. Yeah, God of War, you go inside a giant snake lad. In Yoshi's Island, you shrink and you go inside a guy. In Gears 2, you do it.
It's just a common sort of stock setting.
Yeah.
sewer, office building,
yeah,
tree, forest.
You can almost take like any like
forest.
Yeah, you can, I mean, you can take like any like primal element and be like fire level, ice level,
flesh
wind level, tree level, flesh level.
If you can make a golem out of it, you can make a level out of it.
Exactly. I think some people in chat are trying to figure out what your most positive review would have been.
Portal.
Like, it's not necessarily possibly like your best portal, yeah.
Or oh, Return of the Obra Dinn.
Great game. Hell Pie.
Probably not that one so much.
Probably not Hell Pie.
Weird musical choice for this level.
Oh, I haven't actually had the sound on. What are there? Are there voices? Are there?
No, it's just music, and it's got a, it's playing a sort of. You know, when you were a kid and you turn on the TV like after the closing time, when the TV was just like going to display an ad for the rest of the night.
Yeah,
and it,
yeah.
And it'd play a sort of insipid muzak on the background while it was showing.
Yeah.
It's that kind of music.
Yeah. Was it similar in the sewers, or does this whale level just happen to have the muzak, or is all the music kind of muzak-y?
I didn't really notice
Hayao muzak-y.
I didn't really notice it in the sewers.
Callum says no voices, but there are voice. There's a voice actor credit at the end. What was there? Someone who does, is it like the Banjo-Kazooie voices? Like the what we were talking
possibly
about that the other week. Yeah,
someone like someone just doing the D. Bradley Baker thing where they just make silly noises and they call that voice acting.
Kamja Ninja with a $2 donation. Thank you so much. Says $2 for a kind and positive review of Toffee. That would probably be your all-time positive review.
Toffee is a lovely dog. I wish she wouldn't piss in the house.
See, even the things we love still have room for improvement.
And he's really being a Debbie Downer lately with this cone on his head.
Yeah, I imagine it's strange for him. Like, I assume he's had to wear a cone before, correct?
Oh, yeah. This is the third time.
Do you think dogs remember it? Like, to him, is this the first time he's ever worn a cone, or is he like, fuck, this is like that time a few years ago?
I don't think dogs really remember from anything from day to day, for the most part. They just remember that they love you. And you are where food comes from.
Yeah, that is true. Simple Simon says, oh shit, didn't even see the cone. Yeah, it's a little, it's a nice fashion cone. The fashion police squad got to Toffee's cone.
Fashion police squad would be trying to do something about Toffee's cone, I think.
Shoot you with a fashion gun?
Yes. And turn it into an Elizabethan ruff.
There's been so much talk about Elizabethan ruffs today. That's really impressive.
Just blast a few tumors.
Mm-hmm.
Fun.
I don't remember before you got into this level. Is this whale like a sentient being in the overworld? Like, is this something that like you communicate with? Or
no, I didn't talk to it. It was definitely alive, and it didn't look happy.
Gotcha.
I might as well just get off the pillar and just swing in midair while I wait for the
platform
to arrive.
Yeah. While you wait for your sliced tomatoes to arrive. Andrew Higginbottom says, I'm kind of surprised there hasn't been a AAA big-budget next-gen virtual pet kind of game like Nintendogs or Cats with all the folks out there who can't have pets. I mean, I genuinely wonder if Stray is going to lead a... especially, I'm assuming Stray sold gangbusters, is going to sort of lead a new trend of people trying to make cute animal games.
Well, it wasn't exactly a cute animal game. It was a, you know, post-apocalyptic exploration adventure where you happen to be a cat.
Where you happen to be a cat, but it also leaned into the, like, letting you do scritches and letting you sleep and letting you meow wherever you want.
I was thinking about this earlier. AAA doesn't really do the open quote cozy game that
That's a good point.
That indie games make so much hash out of.
Yeah, and cozy has become such a big indie thing.
AAA games always have to have like the spectacle and the interesting action.
Yeah.
You can't just make something like Bear and Breakfast where it's just cozy and cartoony and animals being nice.
Yeah, I guess Animal Crossing is the only thing that
I wouldn't call that
kind of does that.
I wouldn't call that like a AAA game by the usual standard.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, I think budgetarily, I imagine.
Budgetarily, sure. Folks.
Yeah. But I know what you're talking about. Like,
yeah, it's not really a core game in the sense of like a Call of Duty.
I mean, so was that The Sims? Milky said, I don't know if The Sims is cozy. The Sims can get very stressful.
I would say The Sims is a cozy game.
Okay. I'm trying to think. I'm literally looking at my games to see if like a big... Like Nintendo would be the one I would go to. Like, even like Kirby doesn't seem very cozy because there's... This newest Kirby is like a post-apocalyptic world. Mario I wouldn't even call cozy.
No, there's like intense stuff going on. Princess is being kidnapped and...
Yeah.
Do or die fights with fire-breathing lizards.
Yeah. This was like Viva Pinata. Which again, that's you know, relatively small scale.
And very old now.
Yeah, and very old. Yeah, that was, 20 years ago.
Because I olden days, before, you know, AAA was all about having the best tech on screen at all time.
Yeah.
There were a number of cozy games on, like, PS2, for example.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. George Lucas says, there's nothing more relaxing than riding around in Red Dead 2. Yeah, the games definitely have, like... really great moments of relaxation, but like, you know,
they couldn't have sold Red Dead 2 if it was just cozy riding around on a house.
Yeah, nothing bad could ever happen to you or your horse.
Yeah.
Yeah, it'd be cool to see what you know, a big either first or third party AAA game would look like if they kind of really leaned into that.
Yeah, just the coziest possible AAA game.
Yeah.
Where you're just, you're running a small tea and antique shop in a sleepy village.
Yeah. Oh, that sounds great.
And most of the people who live there are retirees. And too confused by Alzheimer's to complain if you get their orders wrong.
Yeah. I think one of the things I like so much about Persona 4 and 5 is it has those moments where if you have like a free night and you're like, okay, I don't have to go into any dungeons and I don't have to worry about, you know, hitting the next story beat of, especially like in 5 when it's like a rainy night and then that rain music comes on and you can wander around the city and Joker puts up his umbrella and you can like choose. I like those little moments. And then you have to go with Mementos, which is gross. I bet Mementos would have a bunch of poo in it. I think that whole looks.
It's not a sewer, it's a subway track.
Okay, you've lived in the Bay Area. Like BART, full of poo. There's so much poo on BART.
Well, it's a mass transit system in a Japanese city.
I guess that's true. I've traveled around Japan and there's very little poo on the trains there.
Very clean.
Yeah.
Okay, we're just ending the whale's pain.
Oh, it's very dead. Oh my gosh, there is its spine.
Yep, that's a dead whale.
It's an incredibly dead whale.
Oh, new skill available. Let's go for the swing refill. Well, now we can go to another, to a different world.
How many worlds did you play through?
Well, I finished the game. I think there's only three hub worlds. No, there's four.
Okay.
The last one's not really a hub so much as a linear sequence of platforming challenges.
Gotcha.
And then there's a big final boss at the end.
Gotcha. Was there any anything standout gross that we're not going to be able to see on the stream?
Besides the jizz jungle. Where you go into a nightclub full of dancing penises and collect a glass full of jizz.
That was real? I thought that was a goof.
No, that actually happens.
But besides the jizz jungle, no, nothing gross. Ah, that's good.
There's a bit where they basically rip off the Mr. Creosote scene from Monty Python's Meaning of Life.
Hmm.
Which is in the next hub world, but we probably won't get to it.
Gotcha. Kamjin Ninja said, when I visited China like 20 years ago, the train's toilets opened directly into the tracks below. Our tour guide advised us to never walk on the tracks. That's pretty surprising.
See, when you're a kid, you just sort of assume that's how it works.
Yeah. I would assume airplanes, when you hit that button, who's gotta go somewhere.
I always assume there was a good reason why they didn't do it. But for a train, I guess it's probably just going to get, you know, pancaked onto the track, and probably lots of little insects will come and eat it all. Probably doesn't matter so much.
Yeah, we're not talking like, you know, this isn't like industrial levels of poo. Yeah, individual poos.
If it dropped out of a plane, that might cause problems.
Yeah.
People might.
We just hit the anniversary. I think it was the 18th anniversary of the band Dave Matthews Band. Famously, their tour bus driving through downtown Chicago. And they have bridges in downtown Chicago that go over the river, and they're all like graded bridges, and people during nice months can take boat cruises down the river and everything. Mm-hmm. And the bus accidentally released all the poo while going over the bridge, and it just all fell on a tour boat going underneath. And so anytime I've been on a boat in the past 18 years, I have this is 100%. This is very real. Dave Matthews Band tour bus. Dropped a bunch of shit on people in the Chicago River.
I'm not seeing how that works from a logistical standpoint.
Well, they shouldn't have done it. I think it was an accident.
I mean, what bit of the bus did it come out of?
Bottom.
But what was the bus going over, like, a hole?
No, it was the bridge. The bridges that go over the river are bridges that can, ultimately can raise up. And they're made of, like, grates. And so... Like, you can walk on them, but the grates have, like,
it's a grill.
Coin size holes, yeah.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, and so it just dumped a bunch of poops and peeps on all the people on their boat.
And there just happened to be a boat passing by at the time.
Absolutely, which makes it seem like there was some malfeasance.
I guess it would.
Yeah.
I guess never attribute to malice what can be explained by stupidity.
Oh, exactly.
But even so, if you were in the Dave Matthews Band and you were trying to do something that would, like, make for a funny story...
That's
and
it.
You
like,
were
that's
probably
nailed it.
And you're probably extremely drunk.
Yeah, extremely drunk. And you have enough money to be able to be like, we'll just pay him off.
And I could picture them going, hey, let's see if we can, like, release the septic tank at precisely the right moment.
Yeah, and then I imagine probably, like, the poor, the bus driver who's, like... barely making enough means to get by is probably the one who got fired for it.
Yeah, that feels more believable to me than there just happening to be a ship passing by at that exact right moment.
Maybe they kept telling, like, you gotta keep making U-turns, you gotta keep going over the bridge until a boat goes underneath us.
I imagine it gets boring in those tour buses.
Yeah, and you were like, if they were coming into Chicago, that means they were going somewhere across the Midwest, and as someone who lives in the Midwest, it's very boring to drive across the Midwest, so understandable.
Ah, yes. Here's the Mr. Creosote level.
Okay, perfect. Oh, that's what you were... Okay.
Yeah.
When you were naming that, I didn't understand it, but now that
yeah,
I
see, you know, I gotcha. This bit.
Yeah. Yeah, where the guy... That, there was also a Yoshi's Island commercial that did the same thing. Where a guy kept eating so much because they said Yoshi's Island has so much in it, and then he ate one little bit more and then exploded. And then they were like, Yoshi's Island, coming out soon.
Nintendo ads in the 90s were weird.
Things were unhinged. I don't know what was going on.
Ads. Nintendo of America had some weird creatives.
Yeah.
You're just supposed to sell the nice Japanese games.
Yeah.
What was with that Mega Man 1 cover art?
Yeah, who's that? That chunky man getting ready to fight?
The chunky weird man.
Yeah. Tarnish Pants says, is Mario Odyssey worth getting a used Switch for? My friend is offering me his old Switch for $100. Well, first off, I think $100 for a Switch is a pretty good deal.
Yeah, Mario Odyssey is pretty good.
Yeah, I think there's enough.
I replayed it in Mario Galaxy with my daughter.
Mm.
And in retrospect, Mario Odyssey is quite a bit stronger than Mario Galaxy.
I would say that with Mario. I actually like Mario Galaxy 2 more than 1, but 2 is not a part of that collection that came out for some reason.
Yeah.
So I think 2 can only be played on the Wii. No, but yes, I don't have time.
Maybe they're holding out for the next All-Stars collection.
Probably. Yeah, that sounds exactly like something Nintendo would do. Will Cooling with another 2-pound dono. Thank you so much, Will. Said an idea came to me. 2D Mario Metroidvania. Possible. People have made levels in Mario Maker that have Metroidvania-ish elements to them.
I hate these.
Like locks and keys. Yeah, it seems like the friction of you sticking to it seems kind of like a pain in the ass.
Yeah, let's just bypass it.
Yeah. But I'd love to see Nintendo do something different with 2D Mario. I think that would be great. I don't think everything has to be a Metroidvania, but
I think they're done with 2D Mario. I think Mario Maker was like the official end of Nintendo making 2D Mario games.
Yeah,
like, we're done. It's up to you now.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I guess it makes sense. Mario Odyssey sold like 25 or 30 million copies, so
yeah,
you're probably just gonna stick to that.
Do you think they'll ever make 3D Mario Maker? I posited this in a podcast with Jack way back. And I was thinking if you did it sort of like block based, like Minecraft almost.
Yeah,
I could see them making a fairly easy 3D level editor.
Yeah, yeah. I'm surprised they didn't make a 2D Zelda Maker. You know, make top down stuff. Here's all the pieces. Make little dungeons. Make encounters. Place enemies. Place items, place treasures, place traps, like, you know, even if the game was just make a dungeon kind of thing, that seems like that would have sold gangbusters, and I can, like, envision that in my head.
I don't know. This feels like a tall order to me. Metroid Maker, I could maybe see.
More so than a dungeon. Zelda Dungeon Maker? Really? Metroid Maker seems hard.
Zelda Dungeons have always been much more upfront with, like, narrative and stuff.
Yeah.
I'd say. And Metroid tends to be a little more formulaic, and the story doesn't come into it as much.
That's true. Yeah. Matthew BM said that Demon Turf, the aforementioned Demon Turf, the 3D platformer we talked about a little while ago that you did not play, apparently as a 3D level creator. I did not know that.
Yeah, a lot of games have level creators. They used to be more prevalent back in like the heyday of PC game modding.
Yeah. Andrew Hickenbottom says, when are we going to get Ultra Mario? They went from Super to Ultra for Street Fighter. Why not Mario? The Nintendo 64 was originally going to be named the Ultra 64. And then they just changed its name to the Nintendo 64. But it was like revealed. It was on covers of magazines called the Ultra 64.
What was the one that was going to be called the Dolphin? Was that the Wii or the GameCube?
That was, I believe that was GameCube was the Dolphin. Yeah. Project Dolphin.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
So this is one of those redirect the pipes puzzles.
Ah, yes.
We have to get the food to the food critic. so that something disgusting can happen.
Yeah, yeah. Max KO with a $5 dono said, they did make a Zelda Dungeon Maker in Link's Awakening remake. Yeah, I remember that. That was like very, that to me reminded me of like, we were talking earlier this week about the Chalice Dungeons, which, I don't know. I don't have time for that stuff.
That'll do it.
Huzzah. Wraithbow says, I think the Switch for a bit was called Nintendo Revolution. No, the Wii was called Nintendo Revolution. Which kind of makes sense.
Oh, yes. That's the one.
Revolutionize it.
Don't know how they got to Wii.
It was very strange. I still remember the E3 where they announced it was going to be called the Wii, and then they showed everything, and I was like, what is happening? Truly, what is happening?
I remember them saying it was supposed to be like a universal name for every language.
Yeah, that doesn't.
I thought someone would have pointed out that "we" means "year" in English.
Yeah, you would have hoped so. I know they were very excited that they had, you know, the eyes, the lowercase eyes look like a remote and a little nunchuck, I guess. But
yay,
I don't know.
Bully for them.
Fresh Ground Tuesday with a $5 donation. Thank you so much. It says a Zelda Dungeon Maker would be missing the exploration / discovery / upgrade system at the core of a Zelda experience. You fell.
Bugger. Yee-hole.
I feel like the levels need little warp points scattered about, so if you fall down, you can just warp back to the top.
There's warps in the hub levels, but not in the kind of level we're in now.
It's frustrating for a level like this that is very vertically based, that like, oh, I have to redo all this fucking platforming just because I missed a jump.
There is an elevator you can activate to go right back down to the bottom, but I didn't.
Got time for an elevator for jumps.
All right. What was I doing? Oh, yes. Need to get the wheel back on the mysterious device.
Butthurt Gamer with a highlighted message says console names are weird. Imagine grandma wants to buy a new 3DS and the 50-year-old shopkeep hands her a 3DS. It's new, right? Yeah. Nintendo has been pretty bad at naming things. I mean, Xbox is confusing. Like,
yeah.
What about an Xbox One X and an Xbox Series X makes you think that the Series X is better? PlayStation probably has it right by just slapping a fucking number on it.
It's a station that you play things on.
Yeah. And the fifth one is more powerful than the fourth.
There really isn't any particular style guide for naming consoles over the years.
No, not at all.
The NES, the SNES, the Mega Drive, the Genesis, the Master System, the Jaguar. There's no through line there at all.
Yeah, and calling something the Game Boy, is there a Game Man? That made it sound like I said, is there a Game Man? I meant Game Man.
There's Neil Gaiman.
There is Neil Gaiman, yeah. He's in the news because of his Sandman.
Yeah, because his Sandman's doing very well.
Yeah, people love that Sandman.
I guess I should watch that because I've read like all the comics. And
yeah, it seems like folks I know who are big comic fans seem to be digging this first season. So
I just find it so hard to motivate myself to watch anything on Netflix.
Yeah, I hear you.
Okay, that's not going to work.
That's true. Darren did like it. Darren is a arbiter of quality, in my mind.
All right, let's see if we can explode Mr. Creosote before the end of this stream.
Oh no!
It's a classic three and done scenario.
Mm-hmm.
Where did that thing end up? Over there.
Damien Glenn says, my understanding is that there is a place called the Manhole in Wisconsin, Marty, and I suspect you could find the game man there. I've never heard of a place called the Manhole. I think that's a lie. I think that's a lie. If you heard that from Jack, it's a lie. Jack sits on a throne of lies. Dimitri says this.
Double piss and vinegar.
But this is less a ripoff of Conkers and more they were both drawing inspiration from Monty Python.
I guess.
This falling down seems very frustrating. I am frustrated for you.
I should have activated the elevator. I see that now. Yeah, you can only activate it from the top. Whoopsie doodle. Hey, that's not poo you're eating. Know your brief, asshole.
We'll kill anyone with another 2-pound dono. Thank you so much. Will says, thoughts on AVGN/gaminghistorian/nostalgia critic. I don't think I've ever watched any videos of theirs. If they're two person.
I've never watched any of the first two, and what I know of the Nostalgia Critic, I mainly know from videos criticizing him.
Gotcha. I watch a lot of video essays, but not any of those folks.
Have you seen that Folding Ideas essay about the Nostalgia Critic's critique of Pink Floyd's The Wall?
I haven't. I like Folding Ideas quite a bit, though.
Well, you should definitely watch that.
Okay. Is Nostalgia Critic doesn't do games? Does anything nostalgic, obviously, if he has a critique of The Wall?
I guess. He just does old films, I think.
Hmm.
Aha. Skizzles.
Skizzles. Did you summon the elevator? Has the elevator been summoned?
No, I haven't summoned it yet.
Scavenger with a $5 dono. Thank you so much. Scavenger said Atari was trying for something for a while. Besides the Jaguar and Lynx, they had a canceled console called the Panther. Oh, they were just doing little cat consoles. I like that.
What, I think they were naming sports cars?
Yeah, it also doesn't tell you one is more powerful than the other, unless there's like a, I don't know if there's like an agreed upon ranking of cats.
There's a small frightened naked woman over there, but I don't think I'll go any closer for fear of ruining our chances of coming up on the algorithm.
Why? What's going on with her? Why is she over there?
Oh, it's because the demons are making people into food, you know.
Classic demons.
In a really gross way.
Yeah.
Okay, let's not fuck this up.
I have faith in you.
Although I have activated the elevator this time.
Oh, it's tough because you don't have your cherub, right?
I'm carrying this wheel. Ta-ta-ta. Bish bash bosh.
Bish bash bosh.
Bish bash bosh. Not a brain tax of that one.
No. Yeah, that's true. My American Fear says it took Microsoft years to learn how to name Windows properly. Maybe they could finally get the Xbox, the next Xbox, right and call it the Xbox 6. That's true. Windows did have a long history of strange fucking names.
Yeah.
Although everything around 2000 wanted to capitalize on naming something blank 2000.
Certainly.
That's just a heart. This is a giant heart.
Someone mentioned that the zoom in on the things and the disgusting detail being added to the zoomed in version is a very John Crick for Lucy thing. Ren and Stimpy and all that.
Oh, yes. Adam Padilla with a $10 donation. Thank you so much, Adam. Says, I'll pay to say that you guys and everyone in chat should definitely check out the Video Game Historian. Very professional and in-depth info from an actual professor, nonetheless.
Who's are back?
Where? Who's are back? I don't know who the Video Game Historian is. Well, I'm going to look it up, though.
Well, maybe I'll check it out. Although it's very easy to just call yourself a historian on YouTube.
That is true.
Just it's very easy to just call yourself a critic, apparently.
He looks like a historian. He's got glasses, clean-shaven. He buttons all the way up to the top button.
You know who else had glasses and was clean-shaven?
Are you going to talk about Hitler again?
No, I was going to bring up Heinrich Himmler, actually.
Ah, shit.
Hitler didn't wear glasses, as far as I know.
You don't know. Maybe he was embarrassed. Maybe he only wore them he didn't wear them in mixed company. And Fresh Ground Tuesday with another $10 donation. Thanks so much, buddy. Says, I've heard Yahtzee in the past attribute his enjoyment to games featuring sailing ships to reading Horatio Hornblower as a lad. I rarely catch these, so here's $10 to hear me say, me too.
Actually, I never really read Hornblower as a lad. I came to him quite late. And I guess I just got into them because I already liked stories about seafaring. I don't know where it comes from. I just like stories about the sea.
Maybe in a past life, you worked at a lighthouse.
Maybe when I was growing up, I grew up in like the Midlands in England, which is like as far away from the sea as you can get.
As you can get the country, yeah.
Yeah, and for our holidays, we'd go to like Cornwall and get to hang around on the beaches for once.
Yeah.
And I guess I have a lot of nostalgia for being by the sea.
Oh, that's nice.
Maybe I'll retire to somewhere by the sea.
That could be nice. You could hear like a foghorn every once in a while, but like way in the distance, not annoyingly.
Wake up to the sound of seagulls.
Yeah.
The wife and I honeymooned on Kauai, the Hawaiian island that sounds like the Japanese word for cute.
Where Lost was filmed.
We were staying at a really nice beach resort. Our hotel room balcony was like 3 meters from the surf. It was great.
Incredible. Anthony Gonzalez with a $5 donation. Thank you so much, Anthony. Says, greetings from sunny San Diego, California. If our forest fires and hot weather don't get you, the cost of living will. Enjoy your stay and always hydrate.
Well, I can afford to live, but then I'm a famous YouTuber.
Whoa! This is San Diego. Maybe you can't afford fancy San Diego. I think you can afford San Diego.
I'm in East Bay, bitch.
Last night I rewatched the 2003 Incredible Hulk movie directed by Ang Lee. Completely forgot.
Don't all make him place Ang in the Bay Lee. Area. You wouldn't like him when he's Ang Lee.
You know what? You're probably the first person to ever make that joke.
I most certainly am.
I forgot the whole thing takes place in San Francisco. The entire climax is him fucking up Lombard Street. There's a big bit on Treasure Island. He's a professor at Berkeley.
I didn't realize, actually.
Yeah. And I'll film there, too. That was before I got there, though, so I wasn't present when the Hulk destroyed Lombard Street.
So what about the bit set in the desert?
That doesn't make any sense, because it's like, not only does it look like a desert, it looks like an actual, like, dune desert, and then he just hops his way back to the Bay Area. So I don't know how that happened. I think that seemed a little...
Just how far he can hop.
Yeah, he's a big hopper. Scavenger with a $5 donation. Thank you so much, pal. Says, with the earlier talk of musicals, I saw Come From Away live on Saturday. Not enough media of really heartwarming stories during tragedies. Come From Away, that was the... Wasn't that the story about the planes that got rerouted to Canada? during 9/11.
I love the sound of the main character vomiting when we see the when we hear the little jingle after we pick up a pie ingredient. It really adds to the vibes, you know.
I like we were talking about wholesome stories during tragedies, and then you just said I really like how the character vomits.
Well, it's my stream. It's supposed to this be a showcase of the game. What are you doing talking about whatever the hell you're talking about?
I was reading a super chat.
Well, I blame them then.
I'm sorry, Scavenger. I think you're great. Yasi just got help high fever. He apologizes. Come from away
sounds
really
like,
nice.
That sounds like something very suspect. Help high
help
fever.
Help high fever?
I've got the it's help like dengue high fever. Fever.
Yeah.
Like a euphemism for being really into diseased prostitutes.
Mm-hmm. Everyone needs love.
Some of them charge for it.
It looks like it is 5 o'clock.
Oh, good.
It means 5 o'clock. You're 3 o'clock. Probably someone's 4 o'clock.
Oh, good. I mean, oh, damn. I have to stop playing this game. Well, thanks for watching the Post CP stream, everyone. If you're interested in my opinions on Hell Pie, which is what this game is, then go and watch my Zero Punctuation on escapistmagazine.com or on YouTube if you're a YouTube member. If you're not a YouTube member, you'll have to wait till next week.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're not a YouTube member, what are you doing here? We don't like yeah, you your got... sort.
Yeah. Scram. Like Harry and the Hendersons.
I was Yahtzee Croshaw. I was joined by Marty Sleaver.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for having me. And stay tuned in 2 hours at 7 p.m. Central. Nick, Casey, and myself will be back for our new late night breakout. That makes it sound like sexier than it will be. It's just at night because Casey now has a 9-to-5. So yeah, we'll be doing breakout in 2 hours, and then tomorrow at noon we're gonna have more of Nick streaming Lord of the Rings: The Third Age, and at 7 p.m. tomorrow night, Casey and I are gonna be back at it with Snake Eater.
Ooh.
Game and about snakes.
And also tomorrow you can enjoy my latest extra punctuation dropping on YouTube if you're one of the non-member scrubs who we hate.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you keep saying that we hate them. I don't think we hate them.
Freeloading
we just
gets.
Like them. Freeloading gets. Yeah, we have a lot of good stuff dropping this week for non-members. Stuff like Jimmate's Anatomy on Dishonored. Check that out. Darren's In the Frame on authorship in the MCU. Yeah, you're going to have your extra punctuation. Adventurers and I Episode 8 will be available on Saturday to everybody. And a lot of great 3MRs. Check out Tyrant's Blessing, Cult of the Lamb. And then next week we'll have stuff like Thymesia, Midnight Fight Express, Roller Drum. Just a lot of stuff. A lot of games. Too many
so
games,
much
guys.
Stuff. Too much stuff.
Tell them to stop it with the games.
Well, we might not be stopping it with the games, but we are stopping it with this stream right now.
Absolutely.
Yes, that works.
Yes.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone. Thanks for hanging out. Everyone on YouTube, everyone on Twitch.
Toffee can tell something's happening.